Thank you. Good morning. Welcome to this time of worship as we celebrate the life of Marilyn Schaeffer today. Just to invite you to, you can join the family in the parish hall for fellowship immediately following the graveside. If you're not going to the cemetery, you're welcome to go down there and wait for us until we return. We will be sharing Holy Communion today. I just want to be sure you know all are welcome to share our meal. If you're in need of gluten-free, I do have that available. Just you need to tell me. And all you need for the service is found in your bulletin today. At this time, I ask you to rise, if you are able, and face the rear. Welcome in the name of Jesus, the Savior of the world. We are gathered to worship, to proclaim Christ crucified and risen, to remember before God our sister Marilyn, to give thanks for her life, to commend her to our merciful Redeemer, and to comfort one another in our grief. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Eternal God, maker of heaven and earth, who formed us from the dust of the earth, who by your breath gave us life, we glorify you. Jesus Christ, the resurrection and the life, who suffered death for all humanity, who rose from the grave to open the way to eternal life, we praise you.
We praise you.
Holy Spirit, author and giver of life, the comforter of all who sorrow, our sure confidence and everlasting hope, we worship you. To you, O blessed Trinity, be glory and honor forever and ever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our sister Marilyn. We thank you for giving her to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see that death has been swallowed up in the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that we may live in confidence and hope until by your call we are gathered to our heavenly home in the company of all your saints, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
May we say a prayer? May the meditations of our heart and the words of our whatever be acceptable in thy sight, our Lord, Redeemer, and strength. Amen. This is my son, Drew, for those of you who don't know. And he's going to start out the remembrances. And my brother Corey and sister Andrea are going to join in at that time, and I'll end.
Thank you all for joining us this morning as we honor Marilyn Schaeffer, our friend, mother, grandmother, and wife. Again, my dad asked me to share this morning, which I was honored to do, and just so everyone is aware, I'm reading from his perspective as he wrote it. He starts, I found this poem in a book on Mom's nightstand. The book was entitled Poems for the Very Young Child. The copyright was 1932. Mom was born just 3 years earlier in 1929. Scribbled inside the front cover in a child's style of handwriting was the name Marilyn. It was apparently one of the first books she owned. I picked this poem out of the many because it so typifies Mom's view of the world and her approach to everything in life with wonder and awe. The poem is entitled All Things Beautiful. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. Each little flower that opens, each little bird that sings, he made their glowing colors, he made their tiny wings. The purple-headed mountain, the river running by, the morning and the sunset that light up the sky. The tall trees in the green wood, the pleasant summer sun, the ripe fruits in the garden, he made them every one. He gave us eyes to see them and lips that we might tell, how great is God Almighty, who doeth all things well. John Keeble. Marilyn had a long and abundant life, which she lived to the fullest. She grew up on a family farm in Clark's Valley, Dauphin County, and was cared for by her mother, her aunts and uncles, her mem-mem and pop-pop, and her extended family in the area. She attended grade school in the one-room Rainier Schoolhouse across the street from her home. After high school, she went on to study nursing at Lackenau Hospital outside Philadelphia, later worked in cancer research. It was in Philadelphia that she met Edward Schaeffer, who was to become her husband of 68 years. Her long life with us, 93 years if anyone is counting, she was many things to many people, Tiny, Proby, Nurse, Marilyn, Mom, Meemaw, and Grandma. And she experienced an abundant life in many forms, farming life, nursing life, family life, a life with beloved Bandy, and she, as she referred to my father. She was a photographer, gardener, traveler, an avid reader, and a try of new things, no matter what her age. God shared her with us only for a time, and she was a gift from God to all who met her. In celebration and gratitude for the life she shared with us, we will now have a time of sharing. Firstly, her beloved husband, Bandy, Dad, or Pop-Pop, simply shared that he has a lifetime of loving memories that he couldn't possibly pick out one. He sends his love always to Marilyn. Andrea, her eldest daughter, will now share.
Well, I think you all know me. I am Andrea, the eldest of the Schaeffer children. I'm still trying to figure out what perks come with being the first. But I have learned that there are plenty of responsibilities, and I guess being the first to speak about Mom is one of them. I'm going to be a little bit redundant. I'm going to share two things that I cherish about Mom, but first I want to give you a little background. This is the redundant part. Mom was a nurse at Lincoln Hospital in Philadelphia for 5 years, working in cancer research, and we really just learned this probably in the past year about her. Before she married Dad, they got married in 1954 over Thanksgiving weekend break from Temple Dental School, where Dad was studying. Dad graduated in the spring of 1955. They bought a house, moved to Lancaster, set up his dental practice, and learned that Mom was pregnant with me. Quite a first year of marital bliss. Mom left her nursing career to devote her life to raising her children and being a wife and mother. Then over the next 7 years, along came my three other siblings. We kept her very busy. Mom and Dad were always a team. They always worked together. They always put their children first. And though we were not a wealthy family, we never wanted for anything we really needed. Especially, and most of all, they provide us with a stable, loving home and family environment. For that, we thank you, Mom and Dad. Secondly, Mom gave us an appreciation for the world around us. As mentioned before, she was raised on the family dairy farm. She grew up with the cows and the chickens, the geese and the cats as her playmates. The meadows, the streams, and the forest was her playground. From this, she gained a love of nature and appreciation of all things great and small, all things bright and beautiful. Dad was the breadwinner, so she was home with us a lot when we were not in school. And she taught us about the birds and the butterflies and the bees, the flowers and the trees, the turtles and the frogs, and the seashells on the beach. And what she didn't know from her own background, she taught us from a collection of guidebooks that she had gathered together. She would sit with us looking things up and reading about them so that we could learn about what we had found. To this day, we all have an appreciation of the natural world around us, and I think that makes us better stewards of the natural world that the good Lord gave us. She taught us to appreciate all creatures, great and small, all things bright and beautiful. And for that, Mom, we are eternally grateful. We love you, Mom, and we miss you.
Mom, I'm clean shaven for you, because she never liked my beard. Because of that, I'm going to not be able to cheat on my senior discount at Elk Mountain for the season senior rate. Mom, I miss you, but you say you gave me so much to hold on to. I am the man I am today because of you. You injected my passion for everything I do today. She taught me to enjoy sunrises, which we often shared together on our family trips to Stone Harbor and Cape May. Mom was always the first one up, rattling around out in the kitchen, and I was soon to follow. She drank her Ovaltine, and I would sip coffee and would watch enjoy the sunrise. We both love snow, only she wanted just enough to cover up things and make them white and not make a mess. Me, on the other hand, well, there's never enough snow. She taught us about wild songbirds and feeding them. Thought she was a little quirky when she sat and talked to them and whistled and sang bird songs, but now I do the same thing, and I spend way too much money on birdseed. She taught us of trees and flowers and gardening. This past summer, I planted zinnia beds and took her a fresh cut of zinnia bouquets almost every day. And I will continue to do that for this day on. As young children, our parents took us on weekend excursions to Clark's Valley to visit relatives, where we would spend the day playing games in the mountains. The mountains, more than anything, are a part of who I am now. If it sounds like we're the Waltons, we are. And I would sit and watch every rerun episode with her every time she had it on. My heart is broken, but I'm already growing from her passing. My faith has waned in recent years.
Yeah, I know, I haven't been around.
But with her passing has renewed my faith in Christ. He will bring me back to her and all of us and all of those that I have loved. I am grieving, but yet everything is becoming brighter and crisper. The sunrise and the sunset the day after she passed were the most brilliant I have ever seen, and I have them recorded in pictures. She painted them for us. She is still, in her passing, teaching me so much more. Rest in peace, Mom. Tell Jesus I'm not so bad, and I will see you soon. Amen.
Carrie, her younger daughter, shared, "I'm one of the middle children. The quiet and most shy of the four of Marilyn and Bandy's children. I'm not the best with words in expressing my feelings. I'm a licensed massage therapist, and whenever I came home from Arizona to visit Mom and Dad, I looked forward to our special time before she went to bed to give her a massage. Although as the years passed and Mom's health declined, more aches and pains became a part of her life. I knew I could not heal her. I wish that I could have. So, Mom, with this unconditional love I shared with you, I hope you knew how much I appreciate and love you always." Marilyn's granddaughter, Megan, who is Carrie's daughter from Arizona who couldn't gather us, shares, "Grandma, it breaks my heart to lose you, and I would do anything just to hear your voice and give you a hug. I'll always cherish the moments we spent on the porch listening to the peaceful sound of nature that God created for us, and the times we spend in Stone Harbor with the family. My heart is filled with joy, knowing that God was watching over you and brought you to a safe and peaceful home called heaven. You will forever hold a special place in my heart. Rest in peace, Grandma. Love you forever." Taylor, my younger sister, another of Marilyn's granddaughters, shared, "I have had many happy memories with my grandma, or we called her Meemaw. But some of my favorites are getting ready for bed when sleeping over at her house as a little girl. After my evening shower, Meemaw would wrap me in a big comfy bathrobe and slippers and set up the space heater in the bathroom to warm me up. She let me use her powders, lotions, and perfumes while she brushed my hair. It was a special routine for us, and I cherish those memories of being loved and pampered by my Mima."
Okay. I knew two sides of Mom as, among other things, a soft-hearted woman who lived the joie de vivre, or Lebensfreude, and the disciplinarian side, the iron-willed lady, which I struggled with, but it can be a very good quality too. I can remember one time in the summer when our family had gathered in their homestead for a family vacation, a time of bonding and solace. And we gathered around a card table set up in the living room in the exact spot where she laid the last evening when she slept and breathed her last breaths. We were playing some board game involving words. I can't for the life of me remember what it was called. I can't even remember exactly who was there. But probably Drew was there, and he was going head-to-head with his meemaw. They were both so, pardon me saying this word, they were both so damn competitive. But eventually that woman, Marilyn, had us all laughing. She had us laughing so hard and joyously that we actually cried tears of joy. And if Carrie was there, she probably laughed so hard until she peed her pants. But that memory of Mom's infectious joy of life will always stay warmly in my heart. Then there was the lady with the iron will. Whenever I had a disagreement with Mom, there was almost always two ways, the wrong way and the right way. And her way was always the right way. And she also had an intensely private, she was also intensely private with her personal life, and she became only more so in later years. Pastor Cindy, a woman and pastor who Mom dearly loved, was a great example. My sister and I used to joke that even Pastor Cindy is scared of Mom. When Mom became housebound, Pastor offered numerous times to come out to the house, pay her a visit, and give her communion. But Mom dismissed her promptly by saying something like, "Now is not a good time." To Pastor Cindy and to Taylor, her granddaughter, who Mom also used that same expression on and brought her to tears, I have a feeling you already know this, but don't take it personally. She loved you both dearly. So when I tried on what turned out to be her second to last evening on earth, and in my last coherent conversation with her, to have her see my way about her and Dad moving to Londonderry Village, which, from people out of town, it's an extended care senior living community, she cut right to the point. She knew about Londonderry, and she did not want to move there. Now, I was prepared for her answer, and I came back with, "Do you still feel that way when you consider that Dad, Andrea, Corey, and I are becoming exhausted in trying to provide you with your needed care?" To which she had a ready answer. "I'm sorry you are all exhausted, but I am not going there. I just want to die." In my own home. I don't know about you, but she struck me in that moment as excessively curt and callous. But what I didn't know at the time, and she was not telling, was that she was not done in answering my question. Because God and Mom had a better plan. She, in all her love and joie de vivre, had a plan of action. That iron-willed lady was a
That iron-willed lady was going to die for us so we would not continue in that exhaustion. She was going to die according to her wishes in her own home, peacefully and in her sleep, the very next night. The Lord was going to take her to her eternal home. We love you, Marilyn, Mom, Meemaw, and Grandma, and we know you are listening. So, Mom, you did get in the last words. We now know they are a message of love and forgiveness, and that all things are possible for those who love the Lord. My dad, Jim, just wanted to share a verse that sums up this nicely. It's 1 John 3:16 says, "This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters." Thank you all.
A reading from Isaiah. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. But now this says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Ethiopia and Seba in exchange for you. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where will you help come? Or from where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time on and forevermore. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise as you are able for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to John, the 14th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. I have said these things to you while I am still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. So we've already heard some very fine words about Marilyn. Today, as we've already heard, we remember a devoted wife married to Ed for 68 years, a loving mother to four children and a grandmother of four. She was a nurse, a friend, and a faithful member of this congregation for more than 60 years. So we gather today to entrust Marilyn to God's eternal care, the God she worshiped and followed. The foundation of our faith is found in the promises of God's everlasting, steadfast, loving, eternal care. The words from Scripture that we heard from the prophet Isaiah remind us of these promises as he describes the Lord renewing our strength, giving us the strength of the wings of eagles. That same theme is found in our closing hymn today, "On Eagle's Wings." This song is often sung at funerals. And the first words describe how we dwell in the shelter of our Lord in our human life. And our faith tells us that God is our refuge, our rock in whom we trust. Marilyn believed those words. If you've ever been able to see an eagle in flight, you know how magnificent it looks. Watching that majestic bird like an eagle soar can be uplifting in our spirits. I'm sure Marilyn would agree. The prophet Isaiah is writing to the Israelites that they have lost everything, their homes and their homeland. He reminds them that God is always there for them, even in the midst of pain and suffering. And the same is true for us, no matter what we're facing, even death itself. Nature was so very important to Marilyn, caring for those monarch butterflies and watching hummingbirds. I'm sure that she saw God's tender care manifested as she cared for the butterflies and hummingbirds, as she lived that life on the farm and enjoyed the nature around her. The figure of the wings of eagles in Scripture can represent the strength and loving kindness of God's covenant with us, and promise that we receive as we are baptized, and God claims us as a beloved child. That's why we have the Paschal candle lit today. It's the candle that is usually beside our font, and it is lit at every baptism. As we are claimed and we are given the promise that God never leaves us and that nothing can ever separate us from the deep and abiding love that is with us throughout our lives. The words we heard from Psalm 121 remind us that when what we need to do is to rely on God in times of trial and challenge, in times of grief and loss, and that we can turn to God for help and hope and know that God is indeed there for us. I've been here at Holy Trinity for about 20 years, and for most of those years, Marilyn and Ed were here for worship, sitting in those kind of same seats. They're kind of empty now, I think, where you used to sit, Ed. Every week, they took time to greet me as they left. It didn't matter how long the line was. And I always enjoyed my conversation with her. Dr. Schaeffer said to me the other day, well, you know how much she adored you. She talked your ear off every Sunday. It was good, though, to hear her thoughts on those days. I enjoyed to hear her comment on the sermon or the music or what was happening. It was evident to me that her faith in God was very deep. Reading today from the Gospel of John touches upon so many of the feelings we experience in the time of loss of someone we love. Jesus talks about finding peace for troubled hearts, about trusting in God and Christ, and about finding our way home. I think it's evident that that's what Marilyn was doing as she was suffering and her life was coming to an end. She knew her way home. Jesus is saying goodbye to his disciples as he says these words to them, his closest friends. It's the Last Supper, and in less than 24 hours, Jesus will die on the cross, and he knows that one will betray him, that one of those disciples will deny him, and that he will be abandoned as he will face crucifixion. And even though he knows these things, Jesus cares for the disciples. Jesus cares for us even in our weakness. And Corey, Jesus knows you're good. Jesus understands our anxiety. Jesus understands the anxiety of those disciples, and he wants them to be reassured. So he tries to comfort their fears by telling you, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. Those are good words for us to hear today, because the peace of Jesus from God is like nothing that this world can ever give us. The peace that Jesus gives us comes as an unconditional, eternal gift to followers of every time and every place, no matter what, no matter how far we may feel from Jesus. Jesus is there. With Christ's peace, there are no strings attached. There's a wonderful promise of a peace that lasts forever and follows us wherever we go. Jesus knows that the disciples are about to face troubled and trying days, days that will be very difficult. So Jesus gives them and us words of comfort, telling them that the Holy Spirit will not leave them, will always be there. God's Spirit, our advocate, will bring us a peace that our world simply cannot offer. It's a peace that means new life and comfort and forgiveness and reconciliation between us and God. That's why Jesus was born. We just celebrated the birth of Christ. And that's why Jesus became one with us, to be one with our humanity. God's peace is found in the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives as friend and comforter and counselor, teacher, and healer. And God's peace is given to us as beloved children of our God who never abandons us. And in that peace, we are given the promise of life in the very face of death. I know that Marilyn believed in these things, this foundation of our faith, this peace that God can only provide, and I know her faith gave a peace that only comes from belief in God, in something more than the struggles and dying we all must face. So today my prayer is that you are able to entrust Marilyn to God's eternal loving care with the confidence and the knowledge and the peace found in our faith and the comfort in the knowledge that Marilyn is now resting in the loving presence of the God she worshiped and followed so faithfully throughout her life as the example she gave us. Amen.
Thank you.
God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, in holy baptism, you have knit your chosen people together into one communion of saints in the body of Christ. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to share the new life in Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give courage and faith to all who mourn, especially Marilyn's husband, Ed, her daughters, Andrea and Carrie, and her husband, John, her sons, James and Corey, and her children, Andrew and wife, Kelia, Taylor, Ryan, and Megan. Give them a sure and certain hope in your loving care that casting all their sorrow on you, they may have strength for the days ahead. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that where this world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may lead us to bear witness to your light and life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Help us, O God, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, in your grace, we give you thanks because by his death, our Savior, Jesus Christ, destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection, he opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present, nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's share a sign of God's peace with one another from our seats. A few words of instruction about communion today. The usher will guide you. I will meet you in the center aisle and I will give you the elements. You'll be invited to kneel if you so desire, or you may simply return to your seats after you've shared communion. There are little bowls on the sides for you to place your cups in when you're finished. And also, like I said, there is gluten-free available if you need it. Just ask me. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed our right, our duty, and our joy that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who rose from the dead, and in whom our hope of resurrection dawns. The sting of death has been removed by the glorious promise of his risen life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Happy are they who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you that in your great love you have given us a foretaste of your heavenly banquet. Grant that this sacrament may be to us a comfort in affliction and a pledge of our inheritance of life eternal, where there is no death, no sorrow, nor crying, but the fullness of joy with all your saints, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. And as we prepare to, our service will be coming to a close. Just a reminder, you are invited for lunch and fellowship following the committal downstairs. You can get there by turning either direction. There's stairs on either side of the building, or there is an elevator immediately to your as you are exiting. And if you're not going to the cemetery, you're welcome to go down there and wait for us. Let us commend Marilyn to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Marilyn S. Schaeffer. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Let us go forth in peace. In the name of the risen Christ, alleluia.
For to the angels God's given a command. so good.